So we have learned in chapter one, the title of chapter one is the mole and chemical formula. We learned about the mole concept already. Yes, we learned about the mole concept already. We start by looking at the atomic mass. And then if we know the chemical formula, we can calculate molecular mass or the formula mass depends on the formula that we have. Is it in the molecular form or is it in the formula form? And then by doing, by knowing this molecular mass or formula mass, we learn about the concept mole in chemistry. This mole concept is very important. The mole by itself is a quantity. A quantity. Anything that has the quantity equal to 1 mole, it has this number. 6.022 times 10 23 particles. And we must know by now that particles here can be replaced with anything. Depends on what we are looking at, atom, ions, or molecules, or other things. Okay. And the quantity here can be converted into the mass, the weight. Okay. So this 1 mole of things will have the mass equal to its molar mass. Molar mass is a mass of 1 mole of things. Okay, a mass of 1 mole of things. So it can be a molecular mass or it can be a formula mass. Depends again. Compound that we're looking at, is it present in terms of molecules or is it present in terms of the formula? For example, ionic compound formula. Okay, we also learn about the mole concept that is related to the volume of gas at STP. And 1 mole of gas at STP will have the volume of, do you still remember? 1 mole of gas at STP will have the volume of 22.4. The unit is liter, so don't forget about the unit, all right? So now we have learned about mole concept. We are going to start the calculation part with, we will use the mole concept to find out the chemical formula. If we don't know the chemical formula, we can get the mass percentage or the mass ratio, because every compound, the mass percentage and the mass ratio of element in the compound will be constant, and this follow the law of definite proportion. But we are not using the mass percentage or mass ratio in the chemical formula. The chemical formula represent element and the subscript of the number that is the subscript. For example, carbon dioxide here, this subscript would be referred to the mole ratio. So what we are going to learn next is find out the mass percentage or the mass ratio, then convert it into the mole ratio, and this mole ratio will indicate the empirical formula of substance. And if we know molar mass of that substance, we can then get the molecular formula. This is what we are going to learn in this session. Okay, so these are the learning objectives. We know, number one, we get the atomic mass from periodic table of element. And the unit of atomic mass for one atom, it will be in AMU unit. For one mole of atoms, it's going to be in gram. So number from periodic table give you the atomic mass for just one atom or for one mole of atoms. The difference is the unit. And then we can use those numbers from periodic table of element to calculate molecular mass or formula mass. Again, if we calculate a mass of one molecule, the unit will be amu. If we calculate one mole of the molecules, the unit will be gram per mole. Okay, and then we learn the relationship between mole and number of particles, the mass, which is the molar mass, and the volume of gas at STP. Now we are going to learn about the law of definite proportion, which talking about the mass ratio of elements in the compound. Finally, well, we can get the mass ratio and then convert it to the mole ratio to get this empirical formula or molecular formula of compound. So let's go. Looking at the law of definite proportion first, what does this mean? For any given chemical compound, the compound always contains the same elements in the exact same proportion by mass. So these are the example. This is carbon monoxide. This is carbon dioxide. Different substance. They are both consist of atom carbon and atom oxygen. The difference between these two compounds is that carbon monoxide has one oxygen, carbon dioxide has two oxygen. If we look at the mass of each element in the compound, in carbon monoxide, we have one carbon atom and one oxygen atom. The mass of carbon is 12 grams. The mass of oxygen is 16 grams. In carbon dioxide, we have one carbon atom for every two oxygen atoms. And the mass of carbon will be 12 grams, but the mass of oxygen changed to be double that of carbon monoxide. Now we have two oxygen. Each oxygen has the mass of 16, therefore the total mass of oxygen here will be 32. If we don't have 32 grams of oxygen for 12 grams of carbon, we will not get carbon dioxide. Okay, same thing. If we don't have 16 grams of oxygen for 12 grams of carbon, we also don't get carbon monoxide. To be carbon monoxide, we would have 12 grams of carbon and 16 grams of oxygen in this ratio of mass. From this number of mass, we can calculate the mass percentage of each element in the compound using this formula. Okay, the mass percentage is the ratio of mass of that element divided by total mass of compound. Multiply this ratio with 100. The mass percentage of each element in a compound is constant. So if we are looking at carbon monoxide, calculate the mass percent of carbon and calculate the mass percent of oxygen, the mass percent will always be constant. And from this mass percentage, we can also look up for the simplest mass ratio of elements in the compound. It's gonna be constant as well. All right, so let's do the calculation for water here. For water, any sample of pure water will contain 11.2% of hydrogen and 88.8% of oxygen by mass. We can do the calculation to get the mass percentage using the previous formula like this. For hydrogen, The total mass of hydrogen in water is 2.02. The total mass of water is 18.02. So put this in ratio, multiply by 100, we get this value. And this is for oxygen. Looking at carbon dioxide, do the same thing. The total mass or the mass of CO2 is 44.01 gram. The mass of carbon, we only have one carbon, so it will be 12.01 gram. We have two oxygen, so the total mass of oxygen is 32 gram. Calculate mass percentage of carbon, we will get this. Calculate the mass percent of oxygen, we will get this. For carbon dioxide. In this slide, we have this mass ratio of carbon and oxygen. 12 and 32 gram make it into the simplest mass ratio. We divide this by 4. So 12 divided by 4, we get 3. 32 divided by 4, we get 8. So this is the simplest mass ratio of carbon and oxygen in carbon dioxide. So what good would this do to us? So we can use this concept of the law of definite proportion to find out what is the compound. If we do the elementary analysis, analyze how much of each element in the sample, and then try to fit that with the mass percentage or mass ratio of compound, we can identify if the compound is what we expected to be or not. For example, this question, an unknown gas have been found to compose of 30 gram of carbon and 40 gram of oxygen. Question is this gas carbon dioxide? Yes or no? And can you explain why? We just learned about the mass ratio of carbon or mass percent of each element in carbon dioxide, right? So if we analyze this, 30 gram of carbon and 40 gram of oxygen, make it into percentage. Is it the same as percent of carbon in carbon dioxide? Is it the same as percent of oxygen in carbon dioxide? If it's the same, then the answer to this question would be yes. If it's not the same, the answer to this question will be no. So, can you do that? Can you try to do it yourself? You may pause the video and try to analyze 30 grams of carbon is equal to how many percent? 40 grams of oxygen is equal to how many percent? And this is what you should get. For an unknown gas that composed of 30 grams of carbon and 40 grams of oxygen, make a total mass of 70 grams. When we have the total 70 gram, we have 30 gram of carbon, make it into 42.9%. And calculate percent oxygen, it will get you 57.1%. So this percentage of carbon and oxygen do not fit the percent of carbon and oxygen for carbon dioxide. Shall we get to see the previous value, hit 27 and 73, right? What we find out here is 43 and 57. So the answer to this question would be no, this is not carbon dioxide, because percent carbon and percent oxygen are not the same as for carbon dioxide. So if we find the simplest mass ratio For 30 grams of carbon and 40 grams of oxygen, it will be 3 to 4 divided by 10. Okay, divided by 10. You will get 3 to 4. And same, it's emphasized that simplest mass ratio is also not the same for carbon dioxide. For carbon dioxide, the simplest mass ratio would be 3 to 8. Yeah, that we saw earlier here. So from the example before, if we know the mass of element, we can find out the mass ratio, and we can also identify a type of compound, right? So the mass percentage of each element in the compound is constant following the law of definite proportion. Same thing here, the simplest mass ratio of element in the compound is also constant. So if we know the mass of the compound, we can then know the mass of each element and also the mass ratio. The mass ratio of hydrogen to oxygen in water will always be 1 hydrogen to 8 oxygen. And that's equivalent to the mass of oxygen, 16 grams, and the mass of hydrogen, 2 grams, make the total mass of water, 18 grams. If we have more water, become 36 grams of water, that means we have 4 grams of hydrogen and 32 grams of oxygen. Increase mass of compound, we increase mass of each element as well. So if you know that you have 64 grams of oxygen, you can then calculate the mass of hydrogen in water, and that will become 64 divided by 8 because of this fixed mass ratio, and you will get the mass of hydrogen in this one to be 8 grams of hydrogen. And also you can get the total mass of water here by add this together, right? And that will make 72 grams of water. How about the last one? If we know that we have 16 grams of hydrogen, how much oxygen would that be? We multiply this by 8 because of this 1 to 8 mass ratio, and this will give you 128 grams of oxygen. And if you add this together, you would get the total mass of water would be 144 grams. So this is how we use the concept of law of definite proportion. What does it say again? Law of definite proportion. For a certain substance, the mass percentage of each element in that compound would be constant, or the simplest mass ratio of element would be constant as well. However, we know the mass percent or the simplest mass ratio. These are not reflect to anything in the chemical formula. So you see here, H2O. This mass ratio is 1 to 8. It is not the same, not the same as this ratio. So what is the number in the chemical formula referred to? So here, if we convert the mass into mole instead, do we get the number that present in the chemical formula? Obviously, the hypothesis answer would be, if we see the mole ratio we can get the chemical formula. Okay, same table as before. So convert mass of hydrogen into mole of hydrogen. How do we do it? We divide by molar mass of hydrogen, which is 1 gram per mole. Yeah, and this make 2 mole of hydrogen. Divide 16 grams of oxygen with the molar mass of oxygen, 16 gram per mole. So we get 1 mole. 4 grams of hydrogen equivalent to 4 mole. 32 grams of oxygen equivalent to 2 mole. 8 grams of hydrogen is 8 mole. 64 grams of oxygen is 4 mole. The simplest mole ratio is 2:1. This is also 2:1. And how about this? Divide each with 4, you get 2:1 as well. Okay, same thing for here. There will be 16, and this will be 8, and the mole ratio will be 2:1. This mole ratio reflect the subscript in the chemical formula. So we use the mole ratio to get the chemical formula, all right? Which is why you must know both mass and mole concept. So from this example, go back to our previous question. An unknown gas, the same unknown gas that has 30 grams of carbon and 40 grams of oxygen. The question is, what is the mole ratio of carbon to oxygen? Can you do this yourself? How do we get the mole ratio? Obviously, we have to change mass into mole. 30 grams of carbon is how many mole of carbon? 40 grams of oxygen is how many mole of oxygen? Once you get this, you get what is the simplest mole ratio to answer the question. Try to do it yourself, ka. Pause the video and get the answer. This is what you should get. Find number of mole of carbon. Remember, start with the mass to find out the mole. You use this ratio. For every mole of carbon, it has the mass equal to 12.01 gram. Okay, and then you do cancel this unit and get 2.5 mole of carbon. Same thing for oxygen. The molar mass of oxygen atom is 16.0 grams. Cancel this unit and you get 2.5 mole of oxygen as well. Make this into the simplest mole ratio by divide each one with 2.5 and you get the mole ratio is 1:1. And what is the compound here? It will be CO, right? Which be carbon monoxide. Emphasize the answer before that. This unknown gas is not carbon dioxide. It is in fact carbon monoxide instead. So, the concept here is, if you know the chemical formula, you can get the mole ratio. which always be fixed for each compound. And you can also get the mass ratio, which is also fixed for each compound. If you know chemical formula, you can get this and you can get this. How about if you know the mass ratio only, like unknown sample before, you can find out the mass ratio. You can then convert to the mole ratio, which brings us to the chemical formula. Okay, so you can go in both directions. If we know chemical formula, we can calculate the mass of compound and the mass of each element. Okay, so if we know the mass of each element in the compound, we should get its chemical formula too. So these two are related, and this brings us to the main topic of this session. You have to do the analysis to find the chemical formula. And then chemical formula can be in the empirical form, or it can be in a molecular form. I put this slide back for you. You saw this before when we learned about the molecular mass calculation. A covalent compound can be represented by molecular form or empirical form. What is the empirical form? Empirical form is the smallest ratio of each element. Molecular form showing exact how many atoms in that compound. So I told you before, these two has the empirical formula CH. These two has the empirical formula CH2. And same thing, these two has the empirical formula CH2O. So one empirical formula can have many molecular formula. Okay, look back in this one. Empirical formula CH2. The molecular formula can be C3H6, or multiply this by 3. Yeah? Or we can write the subscript like this. So you multiply 3 in make 3 carbon, multiply 3 with 2 make 6 hydrogen. What we can find out from the mass ratio is this empirical formula first. So let's see how. Okay. Empirical formula tells us the relative ratio of different atoms in the compound. The ratios hold true on the mole levels as well. So for one molecule of water, we can say that it composed of 2 atoms of hydrogen and 1 atom of oxygen. Likewise, if we look at 1 mole of water molecules, which equal to how many? Avogadro's number, 6.02 × 10^23 molecules of water. It will compose of 2 moles of hydrogen atoms and 1 mole of oxygen atom. So don't forget about this mole concept. To find empirical formula, what do we need to know? To get empirical formula, you must know the mass of each element in the compound and then know how to convert the mass into simplest mole ratio. It's not different from what we did in the previous example. You know the mass of each element, calculate the mole of each element, and then find the simplest mole ratio, right? So, for example, this one, an unknown gas, again, Next time it's composed of 50 grams of carbon and 130 grams of oxygen. The question, what is the empirical formula of this gas? I find it easy to follow. To set up calculation like this, we list the element. We have carbon, we have oxygen. You list the mass in gram of each element from the equation. 50 grams, 130 grams of oxygen there. From mass, convert to mole by this ratio with the molar mass of each element. Where do you get this number from? From periodic table of element cost, right? For carbon or oxygen. Do the calculation. We get 4.2 moles carbon, 8.12 moles oxygen. And then get the simplest mole ratio. How do you do this? You find the smallest number of mole and then divide that throughout. Use it to divide throughout for each element. So you can then use this 4.2 divide with this. Make this into one, yeah? Divide the same thing, same number here. And from the calculator, you would get 1.93, and that approximate to 2. So the simplest mole ratio in this example is 1 carbon and 2 oxygen. Therefore, empirical formula of this unknown gas is carbon dioxide. Let's see another example. A compound consists of 50% by mass of sulfur and oxygen. This time it doesn't tell you exactly how many grams, okay, but it's give you in terms of percentage by mass. When you see percentage by mass here, let's assume that for every 100 grams of compound, because percent is 100, right? So for every 100 gram of compound, we have 50 grams of sulfur and we have 50 grams of oxygen. You do the same pattern as before. Use the molar mass ratio for sulfur. Use the molar mass ratio for oxygen. Get number of mole. Okay, this is the smallest number. So divide this with 1.6 and divide this by 1.6. Same thing, you get 1 and approximate to 2. Therefore, the empirical formula of this gas is sulfur dioxide. If you don't get it, you can go back, Naka. You can stop and see the previous video again until you understand about this concept, okay? Let's see another example. Now, one sample consists of sodium. This much, sulfur, this much, and oxygen, this much. Question, determined the empirical formula. Where you ask for empirical formula in your head, you must think about what is the simplest mole ratio. So you list up element, okay, list up the mass, all right, and then find out molar mass of this sodium. We did for sulfur and oxygen before, right? Find out the molar mass of sodium, where from periodic table of element, and do the calculation. Find out the number of mole. Okay, I already gave you some, and then get the simplest mole ratio. Pause the video and then do the calculation, nakha. Here, this is what you should get. Molar mass of sodium, and you get this number of mole. Okay, so this is the lowest value. So we divide number of mole for each element with this number. Okay. We get 1, 1, and now 1.5. So here is a problem. When we get the ratio like this, 1.5, we cannot approximate to 2. This is not correct. So the formula, empirical formula of this question, it is not Na is O2. This is not correct. Okay? So what do we do with this 1.5? This is the rule. Okay? When we get the simplest mole ratio with decimal point, okay, the rule is if the decimal point is less than 2, we reduce it down. Or if the decimal point is equal to 8 forward, we increase it to round it up. So for example, 1.93 before can be approximate to 2, right? And this time we get 1.5, which is in this region. Okay? We cannot approximate it. We have to multiply it with small number to make a whole number. Okay? So in this example, we get 1.33. We have to multiply with 3 to get this, and then we can approximate to 4. How about our 1.5 before? We can multiply with small number to make a whole number. This is easy. 1.5 multiplied by 2, we get 3. Okay? So previously, Na 2s to O is 1 to 1 to 1.5. We have to multiply all of this by 2. So, okay, so it will be 2, 2, 2, 2, 3. This will be your correct answer. So go back to the question. Okay, the correct empirical formula would be Na2S2O3. This is the correct answer. So don't forget about this concept. Because in the chemical formula, the mole ratio will always be a ratio of whole number. Okay, it cannot be number with decimal places, right? So try to do this example yourself again to check your understanding. Pause a video and do the calculation. Read the question carefully. Now the question said a reaction between this much of iron and this much of sulfur to produce a compound. It was found that 2.59 grams of sulfur remained after the reaction was complete. Okay. So you have to find out what is the mass of sulfur that is in this compound. Not nine. What is? Easy, right? It has 2.59 remaining. So how many goes into the compound? It will be 9 minus 2.59 grams. And then you get the mole. Find out the molar mass of iron, you get the mole, and then you get the mole ratio. Pause the video and do the calculation yourself, ka. This is what you should get. So what is the empirical formula of the compound? Obviously, it's gonna be FeS, 1:1 mole ratio. What is important then when you are asked to find empirical formula? First thing first, you must know the mass of each element in the compound, and then convert the mass into mole, and then divide the mole value with the smallest mole value, and then get the simplest mole ratio. Then bring us to the molecular formula. If you find the simplest mole ratio, you will get empirical formula. One empirical formula can have many molecular formula, as I showed you the example already. Molecular formula different from the empirical formula in that in a molecular formula, it tells us the exact number of different atoms in the compound. Molecular formula can be the same as empirical formula, but one empirical formula can have many molecular formula. These are examples. Okay? Water is the empirical formula and molecular formula itself, because you cannot lower the ratio down than this. This is the simplest mole ratio. For carbon dioxide, it's the same, okay? But for this compound, you can lower the ratio down to 1 carbon and 2 hydrogen, okay? And this one, you can lower the ratio of carbon and hydrogen down to CH2. So same empirical formula, you have different molecular formula. Same thing here. So covalent compounds can have empirical formula and molecular formula. Ionic compound, however, can have only empirical formula. It do not have molecular formula. We can identify empirical formula by determining the mass of elements and then convert to the simplest mole ratio. And we did this already. The question next is, how do we know the molecular formula? The relationship between molecular formula and empirical formula, you can see the relationship of these both by some small number here, right? You can change this into this form where the inside of the bracket here is the empirical formula. This is the empirical formula, right? Or you can show it in this pattern. Molecular formula would be written in empirical formula subscript with some number n. And if you know the empirical formula mass, or we can call it in short, the formula mass, and you know number of n, you can then calculate the molecular mass as well, right? Like this, CH2 formula mass is 40.3. The molecular mass of this one, which is 3 times of that of empirical formula, will have the molecular mass equal to 42.09. Calculate from 3 multiplied by the formula mass, okay? Or you can set up molecular mass will be equal to n times formula mass. And if we know molecular mass, we know formula mass, we can then find out the n. When we know the n and we know the empirical formula, we can then know molecular formula. Okay, don't be confused just yet. The calculation is not that complex. All you have to know is, what is the molecular mass? What is the molar mass? Find out this n. And once you know empirical formula, just multiply by n, you get molecular formula like this. Okay. Empirical formula of hexane is C3H7. The molecular mass of hexane is 86.2 amu. What is the molecular formula of hexane? What do you know? This is empirical formula. Okay? And you know molecular mass. What you need to find out is, what is the n value? By calculate formula mass first. Everyone know how to calculate formula mass, right? From the very beginning. Don't forget about this. Find atomic mass of carbon multiplied by how many of that. Find atomic mass of hydrogen multiplied by how many. And this is your formula mass. You are given molecular mass, and then you find the n by molecular mass divided by formula mass, you get 2. And then you get molecular formula by, this is your n, huh? This is your n. Multiply it in. You get C6H14. And C6 refer to hexane. Okay, let's do this last exercise. I will leave you with this last question, and you will have to complete it yourself. Okay? The question is, a compound that is called ethylene glycol, it is often used as the antifreeze put in the car. This ethylene glycol contains 38.7% carbon, 9.75% hydrogen, and the rest is oxygen. It is known that the molecular mass of ethylene glycol is 62.07 gram per mole. The question is, what is the molecular formula of ethylene glycol? What is the molecular formula of ethylene glycol? In this question, you have to use everything that we learned in this session, starting from find out the mass of each element in the compound. Okay, and then convert to the mole ratio. From the simplest mole ratio of the element, you will get the empirical formula. From the empirical formula, you can calculate the formula mass, and you are given the molecular mass. Use the ratio between molecular mass and the formula mass to find the value of n, okay, and then multiply n with the empirical formula, and then you will get your answer. I give you this to do the calculation in each step. Step number one, calculate the mass of each element. You are given in percentage, so don't panic. When you are given the mass in percentage, we assume 100 grams of compound. Once you know the mass of each element, including oxygen, calculate the mole of each element and find empirical formula. Calculate the formula mass from the empirical formula and then calculate for n. And use this n to multiply in the empirical formula, and here is your answer. Alright, practice to do this. Until next time, I will give you the answer.